Economic growth is measured as the growth of real GDP per capita. Real GDP per capita allows us to compare incomes throughout time by controlling for inflation and changes in population. We need to revisit an equation that we previously discussed and modify it a bit for this discussion. We previously defined the growth rate of real GDP as the growth rate in nominal GDP minus growth rate of the price level. For economic growth, we are interested in growth rate of real GDP per capita. So that means we need to also subtract the growth rate of population. Here we have an example of an economy that had a nominal GDP of $19 trillion in 2018. Nominal GDP grew to $20 trillion in 2019. Using the equation for growth rates, the growth rate in nominal GDP between the 2 years is 5.3%. However, we know that some of the growth rate was due to inflation. Let us say that inflation between the years was 2.5%. And therefore, we need to subtract that out. That means the growth rate of real GDP was 2.8%. During the same period, if population grew by 1%, then real GDP per capita growth rate was 1.8% only. The growth rate in real GDP per capita might seem small after you take into consideration the other changes in the economy. One thing I want to point out is small differences in growth rates lead to large differences over generations. That's because of this concept called compound interest. Compound interest is the idea that as your wealth grows, your growth begins to build on itself. The unfortunate thing is compound interest also works on debt. This is why it's hard for people to get out of debt when interest rates are high. To understand compound interest, we will introduce the rule of 70. The rule of 70 approximates the amount of time it will take your money to double for a given interest rate. For instance, let's assume you have $100 saved in an account earning 2% interest per year. Your money will double or grow to $200 in 70 divided by 2 or 35 years. To show the power of compound interest, take an example where you save $1 over 70 years. If your interest rate is 1%, in 70 years you will have $2. If your interest is 3%, then over 70 years you will have $8. Your interest rate tripled, but your savings quadrupled. Let's increase your interest to 5. Your savings after 70 years will grow to $30. Comparing to the 1% rate, while interest grew by 5-fold, your savings increased by 30-fold. What if your interest rate is 7%? That means your savings would double every 10 years, and in 70 years, you will have $114. These numbers become more impressive when we change your savings amount from the hypothetical $1 to $1,000. The difference between saving at 5% interest and 7% interest is drastic. At 5% interest, you would have $30,000. At 7% interest, you would have $114,000. A small difference in interest rates leads to large differences over decades. Point being is interest rates or growth rates matter because of compound effect. Let us look at the growth rates by generations. Let us compare the generation of people born in 1947, 1970, 1980, 1990, and 2000. Let us normalize the starting GDP for each year of birth to equal 100 and follow the growth of GDP over the first 20 years of each birth year cohort and see how high their GDP is at the end. A higher ending point indicates the birth year cohort experienced a high growth rate over the same period of time. The 1947 birth group ended their 20-year period at an index of 160. The 1970 birth cohort ended slightly lower at 154. And 1980 ended at 152. starting with the 1990 cohort, we start to see a change in the US growth rate. The 1990 cohort GDP index grew to 132, and the 2000 cohort ended at 125. This indicates that the growth rates of US GDP have been decreasing over the past 60 years. In this video, we covered the mathematical concept that accompany our analysis of economic growth. You learned how to calculate growth rate of real GDP per capita. You learned about the rule of 70 and how compound interest works. You learned how small differences in interest rate lead to large differences over generations. What is left for us to learn is why do some countries grow and others don't.